This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of our risen Lord. Welcome to worship today at Duke Chapel. I bring you greetings from members of the congregation who are on retreat this morning. They are engaging in fellowship and reflection and worshiping at the Caraway Retreat Center near Ashboro as we worship here today, and they send you their regards. We're delighted to have the summer choir with us for the first time this summer today. With the exception of a few Sundays, they will be making a joyful noise with us for the next few months throughout the summer, and we are grateful for the contribution they make to worship. So now, please rise and prepare your hearts for worship.
Thank you. Hail the day that sees him rise, our Christ who hath conquered death and sin. Hear our confessions as we pray. Gracious Creator, you have given us all we need, but still we set our minds on that which we don't have. Lord, have mercy. Gentle Savior, it is far too often that we prefer finger pointing to soul searching. Christ, have mercy. Loving Spirit, we brush aside your guidance if only for lack of knowledge or fear. Lord, have mercy. Yet he loves the earth that he leaves behind and bestows blessings on his church below. By the ministry of reconciliation entrusted by Christ to his church, receive his pardon and peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Close bound by love, all the church in one, let us now share with one another love and gifts of signs of peace that we have received from Christ Jesus.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Risen Christ, you have raised our human nature to the throne of heaven. As we are formed by your word, help us to seek and serve you, that we may join you at the Father's side, where you reign with the Spirit in glory, now and forever. Amen. The first lesson is from Acts, the first chapter. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over the course of 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they came together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? And he replied, It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while he was going and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you. The second lesson is from Colossians, the third chapter. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 24th chapter. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and the forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. This is the word of the Lord.
The living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I happen to know identical twin brothers, now in their 70s, both ordained, both monks, and both Anglican bishops. They have a party piece that they do when one of them is invited to preach on Ascension Day. One brother hides somewhere behind the lectern, just tucked over there, while the other goes up into the pulpit to preach the sermon. At the agreed moment, the one in the pulpit says, "The ascension of Jesus is a difficult event to envisage. Imagine it went something," and his voice trails off mysteriously while he slowly disappears into the lower regions of the pulpit. Until moments later, his brother pops out from behind the lectern and says, "Like this!" It never fails to bring the house down, especially if the congregation doesn't previously know that the two bishops are identical twin brothers. The ascension of Jesus is indeed a difficult event to envisage. For many centuries, Ascension Day was regarded as the fourth great festival of the church's year, along with Christmas, Easter, and Pentecost. But today, in many circles, it's almost disappeared altogether. It's not hard to explain why. Centuries ago, in the parts of the world shaped by Christian faith, people assumed everything in the Bible could be accepted without question. They saw the Bible not only as an accurate account of the character of God and the nature and destiny of humankind, but also as a trustworthy portrayal of the workings of the created world. But gradually, between 1500 and 1800, four things happened. The Reformation took away the sense that the Bible spoke with a single voice, because influential people started to interpret the scriptures in startlingly different ways. The wars of religion undermined much of the church's moral authority because Christianity started to seem less oriented towards peace and more like a pretext for war. The scientific revolution offered an alternative form of authority for investigating creation, to which it gave a new name, nature. And finally, the philosophers of the 18th century Enlightenment shifted the starting point of their thought from God to human beings. Humanity, rather than God, was now the center of the world and the measure of all things. If belief in God was going to be credible, it had to fit into the scientific and philosophical matrix we now know as modernity. Christianity had to adjust to these four enormous changes. In some ways, it's still doing so. In this new world, everything was coming to be valued by the extent to which it meant one of two criteria. Either it proved true to the experience of our five senses, or it proved useful to our well-being and general flourishing. Experience and usefulness became the tests of truth and value. For a period, Christianity could rely on its social dominance to protect it from such examination. But that train's left the station in most places today. So Christianity has set about ensuring that even if its central claims may not be true, it's nonetheless made itself practical and useful, so it's good to have around. I remember standing next to a young man at a funeral. He was searching for meaning through the tears and was watching the body of a person he loved being lowered into the ground. Afterwards, he said to me, "The church is quite good at death. It's just life it hasn't come to terms with yet." Think about those words. The church is quite good at death. It's just life it doesn't know what to do with. They perfectly sum up the ways the church has responded to the modern age. That young man could see the church was relating to his sense experience at this tender moment, his tears, his sense of fragility, and dust returning to dust. He could see the church was useful for helping him mark such a painful threshold in a way that nothing else could. But he had no use for church in happier times, and no sense that its story mapped onto his regular experience. It didn't cross his mind that his own experience and his own judgment of usefulness were the only ones that finally mattered. And in this context, it's easy to see why Christians don't make a big celebration of the ascension of Jesus into heaven. Because Jesus' ascension is an embarrassment by both of the modern criteria. As regards sense experience, the modern mind has no understanding of what it might mean for God in human form to rise up with no rocket boosters and no dangling helicopter-supported winch. It sounds ridiculous. As regards usefulness, what on earth is the use of such a heavenly-bound stunt? If God can do those kinds of stunts, why in heaven isn't such power directed towards something genuinely useful? So Ascension Sunday is perhaps the day above all other days to reflect on how difficult many modern people find it to believe that God exists. The church has tried hard and long to be practical and useful, but in the end, there's a residue of Christianity that remains stubbornly impractical and useless. And this puts the church permanently on the defensive. What I want to do today is to show that there's no need for Christians to be defensive about their view of truth, and that Christ's ascension, far from being an embarrassment, is at the heart of that truth claim. To do that, I want to suggest what's wrong with the conventional way the world thinks about truth today, and then suggest how Christians rightly think about truth. I've said that the conventional secular way of thinking about truth is to judge what is tangible and what is useful. This is where the mistake lies. If God is God, God is just as much God whether we regard God as practical and useful or not. The trouble about putting our own experience and well-being as the measure of all things is that everything is judged by the transitory criteria of whether it's practical or useful for us. Stick with that word transitory for a moment. Everything that's created, every plant, every person, every continent, every planet, every star, is changing all the time. Every time you or I do something, we change. Our history changes and our experience changes, and we become a person whose identity is subtly altered. We are changing every second of every day. So how can we be the measure of all things? How can something that is constantly changing be the measure of anything? Think about the experience of being on a moving train. Everything that's also on the train looks fairly still and normal. But once you try to measure something you can see through the window, it's obvious you can't, because you're moving so fast you can't get a steady view. That's what human judgment is like. We're all on a moving train, moving in time and in space. We don't realize how flawed our perspective is, because most of the time we're judging things close by. But when we go for greater things, it's obvious we're in no position to measure anything. We call ourselves beings. Human beings. Think about that word being for a moment. When we say being, we mean someone still, someone who doesn't change, someone constant, someone who's always true. Being is a way of life that's somehow dynamic and static at the same time. Human life isn't like that. Sometimes we meet a person who has an incredible grace, a wonderful dignity, a marvelous poise, a thrilling stillness. And often we feel such a person is close to God. But that's the point. Human life isn't really being. That's what God's life is like. Human life is better described as becoming. We shouldn't really be called human beings. We should be called human becomings. Only God is a true being. The only being who can act without changing identity is God. Everything else in all creation is a becoming, a creature or thing that's in constant process of growing or changing or dying, or all three. Everything else acts in such a way that it closes off some of the possible options and thus reduces the potential of their existence. God alone acts in such a way that there is no loss, no reduction, just being. We could properly talk of divine being and human becoming. Think about a moment in your past when you wanted time to stand still. This view, this relationship, this music, this sensation was so perfect. You wanted to freeze the frame and turn the relentless video of your life into a still photograph. You can't do it. You can suffocate a beautiful moment by trying to capture it and put it in a jar. That's what makes our moments of ecstasy simultaneously our moments of greatest despair. They're the moments we most acutely realize our mortality. Our lives grow, change, and decay in remorseless becoming. Only God's life remains ever present in constant being. Just look at what that means for the way we think about Jesus. Colossians says, "Seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. It goes on to say, "Your life is hidden with Christ in God." In the language we've been using, Jesus is the being of God, set amidst the becoming of human life in the world. This is why those shaped by Greek philosophy found it so difficult to accept Jesus. It's also one way of explaining why Muslims can't comprehend what Jesus means to Christians. Muslims grasp that God is being, permanent and unchanging, and that we are becoming, transitory and contingent. But if Jesus enters the world of becoming, they argue, how can he still be God? It's a good question. To answer it, let's go back to the creation story. On the sixth day, God says, "Let us make humankind in our image." We always take this to mean Adam and Eve. But in Colossians, Paul declares that Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. What that means is that when God made humanity, God made humanity to look like Jesus. We sometimes talk as if God made Jesus to look like us, but Paul says it's the other way round. We were made to look like Jesus. Our becoming was made to look like Jesus's being. When Paul says, "Seek the things that are above," he means make your becoming as much as possible like Christ's being. And that brings us to Ascension Sunday. The whole story of the Gospels, from Christmas to the Ascension, is of how God's being entered this world of becoming and was subject to the full reality of the human experience of becoming. Most of all, the suffering and agony and death of the cross. The question of Christmas, fully answered on Good Friday, is whether God can fully enter the world of becoming and suffer as we do. The question answered on Easter Day is whether Jesus remains God in dying on the cross, whether he loses his eternal being. The resurrection shows Jesus has not lost his being, his everlasting relationship with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And so the final question then remains, will Jesus take his experience of human becoming back into the life of the Trinity? Will human becoming have a place at the heart of God, not just during Jesus's earthly life, but forever? And this is the question which is answered in Jesus' ascension to the right hand of the Father. The answer is a resounding yes. And that turns the whole of modern skepticism about belief on its head. Modernity assumes that there are a host of things we humans can be certain about based on our experience and our methods of research and our extensive knowledge of the world. But as we've seen, all of this confidence is based on the shaky sand of becoming. All of our wisdom is transitory, and our whole perspective is changing, decaying, and eventually dying. The things that ultimately matter are in the realm of being. Those are the things that truly exist, because they are the only ones that last forever. So our perennial human question, does God exist, is revealed as presumptuous and absurd. God is the name we give to being, to that which lasts forever. The answer to the question is God alone exists. Nothing else finally does. The interesting question isn't, does God exist? The interesting question is, do we exist? Given that we abide in the transitory world of becoming, do we really exist? Hear the good news of the Christian gospel. The Holy Trinity, the one true being, loved the creation so much, enough indeed to long for that creation not just to change and become, but truly to exist, to be. And so Jesus came at Christmas to enter the world of becoming, to be in that world of becoming. Jesus lived a true life of being in the midst of this transitory world of becoming, even to the point of death, the ultimate form of decay. But the God of being raised Jesus from death, and in his glorious ascension, Jesus took the becoming of God's children into the heart of God, that those who see their true being in him shall not finally become and thus decay and die forever, but find their true being in him. Jesus' ascension turns contingent human becoming for the first time into true human being. So Jesus' ascension isn't an embarrassment. It's the answer to one of the most important, perhaps the most important question there is. Do we exist? And the answer is because Jesus has ascended to the Father. Yes, we can.
Please stand as we proclaim our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of all becoming, help us to find our true being in you. Teach your people to look for the things that ultimately matter in the realm of being rather than in the world of becoming. Remind us that you are the measure of all things. Help those who doubt to rely on the things that do not change, such as your love and constant presence in our lives. Be with those who are facing situations that are filled with tumult and uncertainty. Inspire us to seek things that are above and make our becoming like Christ's being. Give meaning to our earthly existence and carve out a place in your heart for human becoming. Lord, in your mercy. God, who is constant and true, give Christians today the courage of conviction. Remove defensiveness from those who believe in your word. Strengthen the faith of any who struggle with belief. In a quiet moment, we name before you someone who finds it difficult to make a public profession of her faith. Encourage anyone who feels that he must hide his beliefs from employers, neighbors, or friends. Sustain communities where being part of a minority tradition can lead to persecution and discrimination. Bolster the belief of Christians in Pakistan, Iran, China, and Egypt. Make the church here in Durham and around the world an instrument of prophetic witness, and give us roles to play in proclaiming your good news. Lord, in your mercy. O God, your Son remained with his disciples after his resurrection, teaching them to love all people as neighbors. Broaden our sense of neighborliness to include all of those in need around the world. Provide avenues for peace and reconciliation in Syria, Bosnia, Bahrain, and Yemen. Offer safe passage to those seeking asylum from places of conflict. We pray especially for the families of African refugees who drowned off the coast of Tunisia while fleeing Libya this week. And we ask that you would provide security and shelter for all people who are displaced from their homes due to war, weather, and economic instability. This morning, we also lift up neighbors across Europe who are suffering under the impact of the E. coli outbreak. Restore those who are ill to well-being. Comfort those who have lost loved ones unexpectedly. And provide ample and nourishing food for all your children. Cool the hearts, minds, and bodies of any who are overcome by extreme temperatures this summer. and keep safe those whose work takes them outside all day long. Lord, in your mercy. God of the ages, you call all creation back to you. Invite us too to join you in the kingdom to come and to sit at your right hand. Like your Son, raise us up to life eternal and make a place in your glory for all people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This week's undesignated offerings go to provide relief for emergencies at home and abroad. Please give generously.
Gracious God, thank you for the loving kindness you show us every hour, new mercies we receive each and every day. Great is thy faithfulness. We thank you that even in our brokenness, even in our becoming, we find your being. Receive these gifts and transform them for the great work of your kingdom. Take our lives and transform them for your work. To you, God, we offer thanks for Duke Forest and for all those who keep it beautiful, cultivating its rich agriculture and maintaining its brilliance. For this, we are grateful. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now unto him who ascends and in turn transcends mortal becoming, according to the power at work through Christ Jesus, to him be all glory, honor, and power throughout all generations, hence now and forevermore. Amen.